are living, truly living in the days he speaks about. All these things we know are happening every day. Let's be ready for his coming. Let us meet him with a shout. For he tells us in his word to watch and pray. While upon the Mount of Olives, his disciples came to him, saying, tell us when these things are going to be. Jesus answered, be ye watching, let each one be free from sin, and take heed no man shall ever you deceive. We are living, surely living in the days he speaks about. All these things we know are happening every day. Let's be ready for his coming. Let us meet him with a shout. For he tells us in his word to watch and pray. Come upon us when the end of time is near. Many earthquakes will be numerous in those days. All of these today we're having, as in Matthew it appears. We should live our lives for him and sing his praise. We are living, surely living in the days he speaks about. All these things we know are happening every day. Let's be ready for his coming. Let us meet him with a shout. For he tells us in his word to watch and pray. For he tells us in his word to watch and pray.
Do what? It is a preaching song. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to do some preaching now. Amen. And I want to welcome those who just tuned in on the internet to listen to us. Amen. And take your Bible this morning, turn to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy and the 3rd chapter. 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, and We've covered these two chapters before, and we talked last week. Chapter 1 of 2 Timothy, well, let's just get around to the theme of this series of sermons, which is how not to collapse when everything else is collapsing around you. And that's really, truly what we need right now. Because as we look around in this world we're living in, everything's collapsing. Our financial systems are collapsing. And they're going to, and it won't happen. It's not going to be long. The American dollar will be worthless, just like the money of Zimbabwe is worthless, and they have hyperinflation, and you wouldn't even believe how much stuff costs there. And it's going to happen in America, because the American dollar is going to fall, and it's going to fall soon. Our political system is in total disarray. Criminals are running the show. The inmates are running the asylum, I guess is the way you put it. And evil is prevalent everywhere. The whole world is offended at something. And as we talked about last week, you know, the Bible says, great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. And the reason everybody's offended is because nobody loves the Word of God anymore. That's why everything's so in upheaval. But but anyway, we talked first chapter of 2 Timothy, we talked about was a call to remembrance. This is Paul's last words that he wrote in the Word of God. The epistle of 2 Timothy is his last letter, and it's to his young protege. I say his young, he was probably close to 40 years of age at the time, but still that's counted young as far as young in the Word and young in the faith Timothy was. But Paul was urging him some things that were very important, urging these things to him that he take heed of them, because he was going to take over the work that Paul left behind. And Paul about to face execution. He was in a prison cell. He was waiting for them to call him so they can take off his head with an axe. And he'd go on to be with his Savior. But he was urgently giving Timothy some instructions And the day and time that Timothy lived in was not so different from the day and time that we live in. Certainly, Rome was the powerful political force in the world, and very much our way or the highway. And Christianity was very frowned upon, even though it was very young as far as the world's concerned. There weren't churches everywhere like there are today. But yet, even though there weren't as many churches, and even though Christianity was relatively young, there were still a lot of deceivers. There's still a lot of false preachers, false teachers. There always have been. That's not a new thing. That's one thing you can count on. There's nothing new under the sun. Everything that's going on today has gone on before. But we are seeing the culmination of God's promises. We're seeing the end beginning to form before our eyes. And before I get into the message, you know, let me just reiterate again that, you know, there is going to be a catching away of the Lord's church. There's going to be a rapture of the Lord's church. Just as sure as we're standing here today, the Lord's coming for His church, and He's going to take us out of this world. But we are going to live up until the last day before that, before the whole wide world goes haywire. And it won't go haywire all at once. It's going haywire now. And so the day that the Lord calls us out of here won't be much different from the day after when the Antichrist comes upon the scene. And I really believe with all my heart, He's already on the scene, but He won't be revealed as that man of sin that's going to rule the world during those 7 years, 7 year period. I very much believe that we've already begun to see those things revealed. So let's get into our Bible this morning, 2 Timothy chapter 3. And again, chapter 2 was a list of illustrations that Paul gave Timothy on just how important it is to be used of God, to sow the seed of the Word of God, to preach gospel to every creature, to keep himself clean from the filth of this world, and to be a worker for the Lord, to realize his sonship in the Lord. So many things that he taught there in chapter 2. But as we wind our way over to chapter 3, we're going to see Paul begin to really warn Timothy, to give him stern warning. And I want to give you stern warning this morning too, because if we're not careful, these things we're going to look at this morning infiltrate our lives, our marriages, our homes, our children, our church, everything, if we're not careful, if we're not vigilant. You know, the Bible tells us to be vigilant. The Bible tells us to see that you walk circumspectly, looking around constantly, being aware of your surroundings, not as fools, but as wise. The Bible tells us that wise men are careful. They know what's going on around them at all times. A fool doesn't have a care in the world or a clue in the world. And I feel like too many people are even though this book is coming, is just revealing itself before their very eyes, so many people are so wrapped up in things like TV shows and music and movies and the entertainment, all the entertainment of this world, the internet. They're so caught up in games and they're so caught up in their phones. They're so caught up in, and I like sports, but hey, you can get so caught up in sports you forget everything's going on around you. I'm not saying there's anything evil with fantasy football, but you know, some people, that's all they care about. And people are so caught up in entertainment that they forget that this stuff's happening all around them, and if they're not careful, it's gonna catch them away up in it. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Well, I tell you, let's read this morning. Let's read the first five verses of chapter 3, and then we'll go to the Lord in prayer. The Bible says, "This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away." Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you this morning for the Word of God. Thank you, Lord. I know that these words are as real this morning as they were when the Apostle Paul penned them down in that prison, Lord. I'm so thankful that the Word of God is current, Lord, that we'll never come to a time when it's outdated. Lord, you're giving us warning this morning, some things to be careful of, to be vigilant about, to keep our eyes out for, Lord, to stay away from, to protect our families, protect our lives from. And Father, I pray that you help me to communicate it, Lord, in a clear manner. Father, I pray the Holy Ghost of God would absolutely control my thoughts and my words and my actions. And Lord, I pray you'd help me to communicate the truth that you have for your people this morning. Lord, I pray that, Lord, you be preeminent in everything that's done and said. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that each one here among us and those that listen by way of the internet, Lord, be blessed. And Lord, that they, when they leave from here, Lord, they feel like they're better prepared to face this old world. Lord God, I pray for your blessing and your provision now. In Jesus' precious name we ask these things. Amen. Amen. I wish I could get up here and give you a nice, sweet sermon, you know, that make everybody feel good. And I figure that's probably done enough on TV. I don't need to do it here. So anyway, but we're going to get into the Word this morning and look at the reality that we're facing. I wish I could paint a pretty picture. I wish I could tell you that it's all roses from here on out, but it's not. It's not. It's somebody said. If people won't die for Christ in their daily life today, in other words, if they won't die to self, what makes them think they're going to die for Christ later on? Really, if you won't die, you know what I'm saying? You understand what I'm saying? If you won't die to yourself on a daily basis, what makes you think you're going to die for Christ when it comes down to that? Amen. We need to be careful, as I've expressed over and over here lately. We need to be careful that we are paying attention to what the Word of God is saying and not just skimming over it. It's not a newspaper. It's truth. And we need it today in this time that we're living in, just like Timothy needed it in that first century. Anyway, let's get into it. It says, this know also. So God wants you to know some things, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. And I want you to understand that word perilous. I know you understand what it means, but it means hard to take. Times that are hard to take. And you know, I have noticed something. A lot of people just don't want to know. They just don't. They just rather not hear it. They'd rather not think about it. I know all that, and I've heard this before. I've heard it from people I love. I know all that. I know. I just don't want to hear it. Well, God says this know. And when God says this know, God don't mean for you to stick your fingers in your ears and go, la, 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 I don't want to hear it. God wants you to pay attention, to take heed, to mark it down, to know it in your heart so that you're not deceived. Because understand something, there is forces of evil on every hand that are working hard, diligently, that understand the psychology of a man's mind, that understand how to manipulate a man's mind, that understand how to tell us lies over and over so big that we believe them. I'll never forget the day that I kind of woke up and realized that most everything I'd learned over the course of my life had been a lie. You know, it's amazing. We start out in kindergarten. Very first thing they do, they put a book in your hands to read about dinosaurs that tell you millions of years ago. It's a lie, straight out of the pit of hell, first day in kindergarten. They want to warp our idea of how God did everything, or even if God had anything to do with it, or even if God exists. They want to put those questions, those doubts, just like that serpent did to Eve in the garden when he said, hath God said. That's exactly the same old garbage that's pumped into our children's minds from an early age. And all through our lives, we are lied to. We're lied to about everything. Science lies to us about things and produces these things as facts when they're nothing but theories. And folks, I'm telling you right now, we're going one of these days on the other side of this old world, we're going to step back and look and say, wow, I sure did believe a whole lot of garbage. I sure did believe that things were different than they truly were. If you really want to know how things are, you just simply have to look through the Word of God, through the lens of the Word of God, and it'll plainly tell you how things are. But the Bible says in the last days, perilous times shall come. And folks, it's getting hard to take right now. It's getting hard to take. Every day through the news cycle, there's something else that's just harder and harder to take. And we're beginning to see these shootings in these gun-free zones on a regular basis. I can't remember how many we've had this week. We've had several this week. And it is nothing more than an engineered shootings to produce gun control because they want to strip us of our guns. And that's all. That's really what it is. And you say, are people really dying? I don't know if they are. I know there've been a whole lot of slain people interviewed on TV at different events, like the Boston bombing and the Sandy Hook, which, by the way, was a hoax, and it's been widely produced that it was a hoax. Folks, I'm telling you, we are being told lie after lie after lie to accept garbage from Washington D.C. Perilous times are not coming. Perilous times are here, and we're dealing with them. We're facing them. And we need to understand these things. The Bible says, for men shall be lovers of their own self. And I'm not going to get into that yet. I'm going to look at this perilous times. God warned us. He warned us in Matthew 24. If you'll turn there in your Bible, Matthew 24. We'll hold your place there in 2 Timothy because we're going back. But Matthew chapter 24, if you'll turn over there. I'm not sure how much sermon and how much Bible study this is going to be. It'll be a little bit of both, but we'll learn something in the process. Matthew 24 in the third verse there, the Bible said, "And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, Tell us when these things shall be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world." Now, you pause right there and look at that word, the end, and understand what he's talking about. He's saying, they said, when are these things going to happen? What's the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? And that end of the world means the time period ending with the resurrection of the dead. That's not the rapture, by the way. They're saying all the way to the very end, when the unsaved dead are resurrected at the last judgment, when they all stand before the white throne judgment, and the demolition of this world, and a restoring it to its perfect condition when God creates a new heaven and a new earth. They said, when is all this taking place? When is all these things happening? And Jesus answered and said unto them, first thing out of his mouth, take heed that no man deceive you. You know why God said that? Because men everywhere are going to try to deceive you. Amen? There's a reason why the Bible says when the Lord returns, will he find faith upon the earth? Because so many deceivers are out there deceiving so many people, deceiving the hearts of the simple. And the word simple literally means stupid. And this world is full of people who are willfully stupid. They're not stupid. Listen, there's nobody in this world who can be stupid if they read this book. This book will educate you. This book will take a simple-minded man and make him a wise man. The Bible says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, which giveth all men liberally. God is not afraid to give wisdom to a foolish man if he'll listen. God will give it to him and make a wise man out of him. But folks are deceived everywhere. Everywhere. He said, many shall come in my name, saying, now take this one right here and think on it. Many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. You know, I've skimmed over that so many times, but let's just think about this for a second. Many shall come in my name, representing Christ, saying, I am Christ. Now, who was that? Who would that describe? Anybody have any idea who that would describe? Do you know there have been 265 popes? 265 popes. Do you know out of those 265 popes, they all claim the position of the vicar of Christ? Do you know that that means in Christ's stead or filling his office on earth? They literally believe that the pope is Christ here on earth. Many, 265 of them, have come in his name saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Do you know there are estimated 1.2 billion Catholics alive on planet Earth right now? 1.2 billion. Now, that's just right now. But think about it. There have been 265 of those popes who've all claimed to be the vicar of Christ and I know the population of the world is growing, but that larger percentage, they say there's somewhere between 8 and 9 billion people on Earth today. Well, let's take that percentage there. There's been at least that much percentage all down through history. So think of all the people that are in hell today because of that false deceiver who sits on Satan's throne in Rome. Folks, I'm telling you, and not only him, but there have been others. There have been plenty of people who claim to have been Christ, but Rome is the center of all that. And the Bible says, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled." And folks, we're seeing it today everywhere. Just this week, you know, we've heard about Russia bombing in Syria. Iran is also, they also have troops in Syria. Understand, this is Bible prophecy coming true. The Bible talks about Gog and Magog and a war against Israel. Listen, all these things are falling into place. That's the people of the north. That's Russia. And Russia suddenly has an interest in the Middle East. Well, it's because America has made such a mess of the Middle East, and now everything is culminating toward world war, and everything is focusing on that little old country of Israel. Folks, these things are happening in front of us. We are coming so near to the coming of the Lord. The Bible says, "Be ye not troubled, though." God says, don't be troubled in the midst of all this, for all these things must come to pass. We're seeing God's word played out. He said, but the end is not yet. Don't worry. The world's not ending. Listen, I don't care how many times they tell you asteroids are going to hit the earth and wipe the earth out. I don't care how many times they tell you that the Teutonic plates are going to shift and tidal waves are going to destroy the world, or the ice age is coming, or the polar ice caps are going to melt and global warming is going to fry us all. That's all just baloney. It's going to happen the very way that the Bible predicts it to happen in Revelation and nothing else. So don't let things trouble you. Get in the Word of God. Study the Word of God, and you don't have to be afraid. Amen? The Bible says, for nation shall rise against nation. And right now, again, we're seeing the United States and Russia beginning to rise against each other again. And kingdom against kingdom. That's governments and kingdoms where there's actually kings. And the Bible says there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places, and all those things have been happening now for years. It's been getting worse and worse and worse. There have been more and more droughts, and a lot of these things I know are engineered, but nevertheless, God predicted these things. Amen? And the Bible says all these are the beginnings of sorrows. The beginnings of sorrows. That's referring to when a woman first feels that first contraction. The baby's coming. And it's going to be a lot of pain and suffering before that baby arrives. But when she feels that first, oh, I don't know, we may need to go to the hospital. Oh, you know, I start getting closer and closer. That's the kind of thing God's describing here when he says the beginnings of sorrows. We are beginning to see the pains that are going to take place during that 7-year period of tribulation. I'm telling you right now, God is telling us, He's giving us warning from His Word that we are approaching those days. These things are beginning to happen. The Bible says, and they shall deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you. Are we not seeing that happen with more frequency around the world as people are dying for their faith? Even in Oregon, they died for their faith just this past week. Amen. The Bible says, ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Folks, we're told today that being a Christian is a mental illness. It's just the way it is. We have a Muslim who is sitting in the highest office of the United States of America who hates Christians, who has spoke out in many, many different times and many different ways explaining that he is a Muslim and that he will stand with Muslims should the political wind shift in an ugly direction. He said that. He calls the Quran the Holy Quran. He bowed to the king of Saudi Arabia as any other Muslim would do. Folks, we're in a bad shape in this nation. The Bible says that then shall many be offended. Again, many are offended. They hate this Bible. They hate Christ. They hate you and I. Why? Because every day we live upon this earth, every day someone preaches this book, they are being told that they are lost and in their sins, and they don't want to hear it. That's why they removed the Ten Commandments from the Oklahoma state capitol this past week under the cover of darkness. Folks, that's why they unveiled a satanic statue in Detroit, Michigan. Folks, we are living in these days. We are truly living in these days. I have a picture on my laptop here right in front of me when we were talking about the Pope. They've got him, you know, he's got on his little white beanie cap and he's got his white dress on and they've got a little white lamb over his shoulders. You know what they're trying to say? He's Christ. Folks, we're living in these perilous times. They're not coming. They're here. Many shall be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. We're living in that hour. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. I think I only have to think about, again, the Pope's visit to America. We've seen with the Pope's visit to America, we see all these so-called leaders in Christianity, and they're not leaders at all. They're deceivers. They're liars. They're out of the pit of hell. Your Joel Osteens and your Kenneth Copelands and your T.D. Jakes and your Paula Whites and your Joyce Myers and all these false teachers who are liars and deceivers who would have you to believe that godliness is gain, who live in these multi-million dollar mansions and fly on billion dollar Lear jets. And listen, and they claim that they represent Christ. No, what do? They go and they pray with the Pope and they call him a holy man. And your Rick Warrens, who wrote your purpose-driven life and purpose-driven church and who's a big player in Christianity, who's supposed to be Baptist, but he's not. Listen, folks, they all have yoked up with the Pope. They call him their Pope. They're ushering in this one world religion. In New York City, just it was last week or the week before, they signed an initiative called Agenda 2030, which is the promise of the new world order, which will be completely in place, they say, by 2030. Lord knows we are living in these days, and many are deceived. And because iniquity shall abound, the Bible says, because so much sin is everywhere, always in front of you, shoved down your throat, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Now, I looked up that word love. That's not talking about lost people, folks. That's not talking about the lost and dying world. The love, the agape, God's love. The only way you can have agape is that Christ live in you. The Bible says because iniquity shall abound, because there's so much sin everywhere, the God's love in Christians' lives shall grow cold. You know what it literally means? It means cooled off by blowing. You know what it reminded me of? Won't let Satan blow it out. I'm going to let it shine. Won't let Satan blow it out. And that's exactly what, I believe that may be where that song came, where that line of that song came from. I don't know. I can't say for sure, but it sure sounds like it fits. Amen. Satan is trying to blow out your light. In this day and time, we'll get so discouraged. We get so tired of hearing it over and over, day after day, and looking around and seeing all the violence around us and seeing so many people who claim the name of Christ yielding to the filth of this world, that you begin to say, well, what's the use? Why do I keep fighting so hard to try to walk with God when everybody around me is giving up? It will discourage you if you don't stay in the Word of God and near the Lord Jesus Christ. It will cause your light to go out. Jesus has warned us because Satan is trying to blow out your light. Let it shine. 1 Timothy, turn to 1 Timothy. We ain't even got off the first line. I know I got to hurry, Brother James. I know I got to hurry. Pray for me. 1 Timothy. You know, I sit there Saturday nights agonizing over these messages, and I think, man, this ain't going to, I won't have enough to say. I'll be done in 5 minutes. It never works out that way, though. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 through 3. The Bible says, now the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, speaketh expressly that in the latter times, and those are the days we're living in, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Now hold on. What's he telling us? He's saying in the last days, some shall depart from the faith. He's warning of the danger of apostasy. Those can't nobody leave the faith that wasn't ever in it. Amen? That's what apostasy is. That's people who say, you know what? I thought I wanted Christianity, but I don't want a part of that. And they walk away. Amen. You say, were they ever saved? I don't think they were, because I'm going to tell you right now, he's lived in me, and I've been bad, and I've done wrong in my life. But I'm going to tell you something. Ain't no way I could turn my back on him, because he saved me, and I have eternal salvation. Amen. But listen, there's going to be lots of people going to walk away from the faith. So, yeah, they tried to serve God. They came into the church. They had a religious experience. They tried, but they never listened. Amen. Giving heed to seducing spirits. There's the danger of deception. The danger of deception. It's everywhere. Seducing spirits. Again, you got people who sit and they get church on TV. And they think they're getting church. They think they're really, hey, I can't go to the church down the street because it's too much trouble for me to get up and get dressed. It's too much trouble for me to get in the car. It's too much trouble for me to have to go down there and come back home. Even though if they need something at Walmart, they jump in the car and go get it. Amen. But they don't. So it's easier for me to sit in my pajamas and scratch my dirty head and watch Joel Osteen smile and wink at me and shine his pearly teeth at me and tell me how I can be a better person. Oh, I can sit and listen to some woman sound like she's hollering like a man up there and barking at me and telling me something. Listen, that ain't godly either. God says a husband of one wife, woman can't be a husband, no matter how hard she tries, no matter what the law says today. Amen. Amen. Listen, and he said, and they'll be given to doctrines of devils. There's false teaching everywhere. Everywhere. That's Satan's plan. Satan couldn't destroy this Bible right here, this old King James Bible. He couldn't get rid of it. He tried. Hey, there's a reason why so many were burned at the stake. There's a reason why he tried everything he could to eliminate this Bible right here. He's still trying to eliminate this Bible. So what he's done is he has flooded the market with counterfeits. He's flooded the market with Bibles that say almost the same thing, but it don't say the same thing. And can I say that God's not a schizophrenic? God's not a schizophrenic. God doesn't say it one day one way and another way the next way and the next day and so on and so forth. There's over 300 versions in English. I'm sorry, but God is not a schizophrenic. Amen? So they want to do everything they can to confuse. And see, Satan knows he can't get rid of old-time religion. He knows he can't get rid of the gospel. So what does he do? He just perverts the world with a whole bunch of different false gospels. There's a danger out there everywhere. And the Holy Ghost of God is trying to warn us. He says they're speaking lies in hypocrisy. What are you talking about there? They're using Christianity as a disguise. Come on, y'all. How many of y'all seen Peter Popoff? Y'all know who he is? He's on late night TV. Well, Thomas got his hand up back here. Thomas watches too much late night TV, I think. Peter Popoff, he's a fraud. He's a charlatan, a snake oil salesman. He's been busted over and over for having a little earpiece in his ear and his wife back there reading prayer cards to him and calling out people's name and claiming they're going to be healed and claiming he heals them. He's no different than Benny Hinn. He's no different than any of those dudes. But you know what? He's got people fooled because he's using Christianity as a disguise. How many of y'all remember Robert Tilton? Used to be on the radio, TV from Dallas. He's seeing something. He's getting something from God all the time. He just punches up when God speaks to him. He was a liar, and he's been found out to be a fraud over and over and over. And all these guys are frauds. All of them are frauds. But you see, they use Christianity as a front for their false teaching. And the Bible says, and they're having their conscience seared with a hot iron. It doesn't bother them to lie to you. It doesn't bother them to use Jesus as a get-rich-quick scheme. It doesn't bother them that they're on their way to hell. It doesn't bother them that they're dragging countless hundreds of thousands, if not millions, to hell with them. Their conscience is seared as if someone took a hot branding iron and hit the nerves where they can't be felt anymore. That's what God calls being given over to a reprobate mind, when they just don't care anymore. Amen? The Bible says, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving to them which believe and know the truth. I looked at that and I said, now wait a minute, how's that fit? Forbidding to marry. Can I tell you something? I really believe with all my heart that may be speaking not just about the Roman Catholic Church where the priests forbid to marry and all those things. But I really think it may be also talking about the same-sex marriage in America. Because same-sex marriage in America is destroying the American family. It's destroying the institution of marriage. I want to give you a quote from an article I read this week. It's called The War on Marriage. It says, the American mainstream and even the gay community itself have no idea that their support of same-sex marriage actually enables the far left to achieve the takedown of marriage it has long desired. Most chillingly, they have no idea that their support of gay marriage also allows the far left to attack religion, its long-rivaled foe, in a way it never thought possible. With such wide public acceptance, they are oblivious to the older, deeper forces at work. The devil is trying to destroy the institution of the American family because, why? Because it is a picture that God established. I believe it was in George Orwell's book, 1984. In that book, that dystopian society that he wrote about, which America is moving toward, marriage is forbidden. And folks, we're heading toward that picture, that image, where the American family is no longer needed. You know why? Because the family, the husband represents the Lord Jesus Christ. The wife represents the church. And no wonder they want to destroy that. No wonder they want to get rid of that picture. And then I read that about commanding to abstain from meats. Well, I read an interesting article yesterday. The Federal Bureau of Prisons, a subdivision of President Barack Obama's Justice Department, has banished all pork products from the menus in all federal prisons, according to a report in the Washington Post. The government said it made the decision to do this because a survey showed that inmates do not like eating pork products. I think somebody got their facts wrong. You're gonna tell me all them prisoners don't want bacon in the morning? Oh, come on now. The Council on American Islamic Relations said, we welcome the move by the government to deny pork to prisoners, but warned that it might spark Islamophobia. It might spark lack of bacon phobia. Amen. I don't know about Islamophobia, but listen, that folks, we're seeing stuff like this happen. I mean, simple things like that, but you think, well, that ain't got nothing to do with the Bible. Well, I don't know about that. We're seeing things we've never seen before. We're hearing things we've never heard before. Things are happening that are crazy and don't make sense. And listen, this world that we're living in is not going to make sense when the Lord Jesus returns. Let's get back to our text this morning. Perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. Selfish, self-centered, all about me, not about you. That's the absolute opposite of Christianity. The Bible says, what's the first and greatest commandment? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, strength. And the second one is like unto it, which means it is literally the same thing. Love thy neighbor as thyself. And if you're self-centered, if you're selfish, you know, all you care about you. You don't care anything about your neighbor. You don't care if your neighbor dies and goes to hell. People, I'm telling you, this new world order is going to rob people of the desire to preach the gospel. It is going to rob people. They're going to say there's no need. Nobody wants to hear it anymore. Just keep that stuff within the four walls of your church. Don't bring that out in the public marketplace. Don't you be trying to witness nobody at work. Don't you be trying to witness nobody. We're gonna crack down on it. It's coming. It's already, what am I saying? It's coming. It's here. I know preachers that have been arrested for preaching the gospel. And I mean that go back and go back and go back and risk imprisonment, risk everything. Why? Because of Christ. Amen. There's a man in a prison in Iran today. He's been there serving an 8-year sentence, Saeed Abedini. He's there. Why? Because he preached the gospel of Christ. And there are many others who are dying every day for their faith. The Bible says, lovers of their own self. It says they'll be covetous in that day, greedy of gain, immoderately desirous of accumulating property. Give me more, give me more, give me more, give me more. Again, when I look, and understand, Paul's not writing this about the world. He's writing this about the church. He's writing this about people who are naming the name of Christ. He's telling us what's going to happen. Listen, I'm telling you, the church, the Lord's church is not about, let's see how big a buildings we can build. The Lord's church is not about, let's see how much property we can amass. Let's see how much stuff we can own. No, it's about, let's see how many people can get saved. Let's see how many people can miss out on the flames of hell that can go to heaven and be in the presence of the Lord for all eternity. That's what we're to be about. Not about things. Things are going to burn. I don't want to burn with them. Amen. Listen, I'm thankful I'm saved today. Praise God. But I'm telling you, we better be careful that we don't get our eyes on the things that the world gets their eyes on. The Bible talks about there'll be boasters. That's empty pretenders. Oh, how many empty pretenders sit on church pews this morning all around Paris, Texas even. Empty pretenders. It's like people that go out and buy a book and put it on their bookshelf, they ain't never read it, but they'll display it like, hey, that's a good book. You ought to read that. Listen, they ain't never read it. They've cracked the cover. They just want people to think they're smart, amen? And there's people that sit on the church pews, that put money in the offering plate, that hold them songbooks and sing them songs and mouth the lyrics and never pay any attention to what they're singing, hold Bibles in their laps, nod their heads up and down, and they're no more saved than a jackass out in the barnyard. I'm telling you, there are phonies everywhere. And we better watch out. We better watch out lest they infiltrate and take over. Folks, I'm telling you, that's the day we live in. Honestly, most churches, I think there's probably more lost people running them than they are saved people in this day and time we live in. The Bible says in 2 Peter 2:18, for when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lusts of the flesh. Through much wantonness, those that were clean escape from them who live in error. We better be careful because, listen, folks are impressed. They are impressed by words. Listen, I'm going to tell you, the only words that truly matter to me are the words of this book. Amen. If your words don't line up with the words of this book, then I ain't got much use for you. And God warns us to be careful of people like that. Proud, he said. Proud. People showing themselves above others, with a conceited estimate of one's means or merits, despising others, and even treating them with contempt. How many times have I seen that? Where somebody will look down their nose at somebody else because they may not have as much as them or some other reason in life. They look down their nose at somebody else as if they're lesser of a person than them. Let me tell you something. All of us are just worthless pieces of garbage that God cleaned up and saved. That's it. None of us have a right or reason in this world to think ourselves any better than any other person. Ever. Proud. James 4:6 says, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. I tell you right now, pride is a very, very, very dangerous, deadly thing, and it will destroy you. It will make you into the very thing that you hate. It will, folks. I'm telling you, it will make you into somebody that if you really could stand outside yourself and look at yourself, you'd detest yourself. We better be careful that we don't allow pride to destroy us. Then he says they're blasphemers. One who speaks of God in irreverent terms. Folks, that's prevalent. How many times people say, oh my God, what are they saying? They're using God's name in vain. They're using God's name for nothing. That's what in vain means, for nothing. Listen, they make jokes about God. They make lighthearted comments. Listen, I'm telling you right now, God is holy. And we're to fear Him. We're to revere Him. The Bible tells us that we are. The Bible says in 2 Peter 2:12, but these as natural brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed speak evil of the things that they understand not and shall utterly perish in their own corruption. If that's the way God describes those who speak of Him, of His name in irreverent terms, why in the world would a Christian ever line themselves up with someone like that? Why in the world would we ever allow ourselves to stoop to the level to joke about the things of God, to make light of His name, to ever use His name in a way that brings a bad light on Him? Oh, God forbid that we should do that. We need to be careful. We need to clean up our language. We need to clean up the way we talk in order to please God and to honor Him. Because, folks, you and I have a testimony before man. And if we don't honor God with our words, we have no testimony to back up the gospel that we're commanded to preach. Look up here, son. The Bible says disobedient to parents. Just want to make sure he's awake. Amen. Disobedient to parents. We're talking about perverse, stubborn, inflexible, unyielding, willfully disobedient, out of control. We got a world full of kids like that. A world full of them. Can I tell you, there's only one way to raise a good kid, and that's by this book. That's the only way. Folks, if you train up a child, you train up a child. You keep him on the tracks of the Word of God. Train up a child in the way he should go, then he's not going to turn back from it. The Bible says even when he's old, he shall not depart from it. It doesn't mean he'll start out right and then he'll go bad for a long time and then he'll come back. Now that may happen. It may very well happen, but that's not what God's saying. God's saying if you train them up right, they'll stay on the tracks. You head them in the right direction. You teach them right from the beginning, they'll stay on the right tracks. Folks, I'm going to tell you, there's nothing worse, nothing more defeating than a child who will absolutely not listen, who just butts heads against you constantly. And God help me, I was one of them. Amen. I thank God He got a hold of me because I was just as bad as that. Amen. I thank God that He changed my old heart. He talks about those that are unthankful. Unthankfulness, ungracious, hateful, wicked, abominable, ungracious. In other words, God, how much grace has God given you? How much grace has He shown you? I mean, listen, every one of us deserved being hell this morning. That's it. That's truth. Every single one of us have sinned against Him. Every single one of us have failed Him time and time and time and time and time and time and time again. Over and over. And yet, how many of us, when someone has failed us, have turned around with a sharp tongue and a pointing finger and blasted them and gave them no grace whatsoever for failing us? It reminds me of that story that man who went before the ruler. He owed him a great sum of money. It was just an incredible amount of money. And he threw himself on that ruler's mercy and begged for mercy. And the ruler gave him mercy and forgave him his debt. And then he went out and a man owed him just a few dollars. And he turned him over to the tormentors. I mean, he was harsh on him. And when that ruler found out about it, he grabbed that guy and threw him in the prison. You know why? Because he showed no mercy where he was shown mercy. And that's the kind of thing God's warning us here through the Apostle Paul. We better be careful that we don't ever become that person. God is warning us because there are people like that everywhere in the world today. And if we're not careful, we'll be sucked in with them to be ungracious to others. Amen. That goes exactly the opposite of what Christ is teaching us. Without natural affection, inhuman. We see that all the time. Listen, that's what abortion is. It's inhuman. To murder one's own young inside their womb is inhuman. It's abominable. It's murder. Inhuman behavior. And I'm telling you right now, sodomy is inhuman behavior. It goes against everything in nature. God hates it. I mean, good night. He destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah on account of it. And God, and by the way, don't think for one second that Pompeii wasn't an act of God as well. When that when Mount Vesuvius erupted and killed all them Greeks who were given to sodomy. Don't think for one second that the Roman Empire didn't fall because of sodomy. And America is falling today because of abortion and sodomy. And not only that, but there's also something else that's going on today that people don't talk about so much, but it's called eugenics, and that's where we're going to try to kill as many elderly as we possibly can. I saw it firsthand myself with one of our dear members who went to that hospital for a urinary tract infection and was allowed to die. Sweet, sweet dear Miss Betty, allowed to die because it just didn't pay to keep her alive when they could have got her well in no time. I'm scared for anybody who's elderly to go into the doctor anymore because I'm afraid they're going to end up in the hospital, put on a death watch. Folks, that's the hour we live in. Understand something. Down there in Georgia, there's some Georgia Guidestones. I don't know if y'all familiar with them or not, but it's the Ten Commandments of the New World Order. They were put there years ago by somebody by the pseudonym R.C. Christian, and one of those things in that list on the Georgia Guidestones is to reduce the population of the world to about 500 million people. That's the plan they're working on. That's what abortion is. That's what the big pharma, where they're trying to kill everybody with medicine, and they're trying to also kill off as many elderly as they can. Folks, that's the hour we live in. It's horrible. It's inhuman. But you say, well, how does that affect me, preacher? Well, I'll tell you, if you continue to see it, you continue to look at it, and it doesn't bother you, you're going to get to where you accept it. That's the danger we live in. Listen, that's why you don't need to let your kids sit and watch violence on TV. That's why you don't need to let them sit and play video games that practices violence. Because what happens is, after a while, it don't bother you no more. That's how come we've got a generation of kids that killing don't bother them. Folks, so much I want to say to you this morning, I don't have time to say it all. That's why this generation we live in is gone so haywire. They've just had violence and corruption pumped into their veins ever since they've been little. And they're jaded. They can't feel like they ought to. There's no tenderness in their hearts like there used to be. Why? Because it has been taken away from them by inhuman behavior. The Bible says truce breakers. We're warned of truce breakers. That's those that are not appeasable. They're irreconcilable. There's nothing that you could do to make them happy. There's nothing you could do to have peace. Listen, we've got a generation of people like that. They don't want no peace. They don't want no peace with us. They want no peace with this book. They want no peace with God. They just want God gone. They just want him out of their subconscious. They want him out of there. False accusers. And I spoke a little bit about that earlier. False accusers. That's false accusers who are going to lie against Christians, who are going to try to do their best to smear Christians. But listen, that's not only that. There's stuff like that going on in America right now. There's a certain thing called false flags. That's where we create something, we blame it on something else. That's where gun control, that's what I was talking about. Listen, all these shootings, most of these are generated. And they're generated by people who are on psychotropic drugs and they're easily manipulated to go in and just kill. Why? Because they want to take the guns away, because once they take the guns away, then they can take Christianity away and can't nobody say a word because there's no threat. That's what happened in Nazi Germany, and that's what's happening in America. Conspiracies, that's where they come from, false accusers. Amen? This world's full of conspiracies, and they're not theories. They're truly happening around us. Incontinent. It means you can't control yourself, but it's not just that. It's not restraining the appetites or passions, particularly the sexual appetite. We live in a day and time where this happening all around us, where people are, I mean, when you take away all restraints of decency, when children's minds are infiltrated with sexual behavior on the television, in movies, in games, and just in everyday conversation, you create an appetite in a child who cannot control their passions. And that grows up into an adult who's not able to control their passions, which leads to criminal behavior. And folks, it's everywhere. It's in pulpits. It's in the pews. We see preachers fall all the time because they can't control their own sexual appetites. It's a destruction of God's people. And it's all purposed. It's all planned. It's all taken place by the deceiver. It's all taken place because Satan is trying his best to put an end to Christianity once and for all. He's not going to be a success. But I'm telling you right now, he's working and he's trying everything he can to get people to look at Christianity and say, you know, I want no part of that. Look at all the mess that's involved. Folks, we're living in a very, very, very dangerous hour. Fierce, violent, ferocious. We're seeing that everywhere. We're seeing riots. We're seeing all kinds of things. Despisers of those that are good. Isaiah 5:20 says, "Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter." Oh my goodness, it's everywhere. The world is on its head. The world is upside down. Folks, I got to hurry and get done with this message. There are traitors he warns us of. The Bible says in Luke 21:10-12, "Then he said he unto them, Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in diverse places, and famines and pestilences and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven. But before all these they shall lay their hands on you, and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues, and into prisons, being brought before kings and rulers, for my name's sake." Matthew 10:21-22 says, "And the brother shall deliver up the brother to death, and the father the child, and the children shall rise up against their parents, and cause them to be put to death. And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved." And I've said before, he's enduring to the end because he is saved. You don't endure to be saved. You endure because you are saved. But folks, these days are closing in on us very soon to where Christianity is going to be illegal in America. I mean, when you start erecting satanic statues and taking down Ten Commandment monuments, well, you're in dangerous ground. You're on dangerous ground. These days are coming to a close of freedom of preaching the gospel. Once they take away the Second Amendment, listen, the First Amendment's right behind it. The Second Amendment protects the First Amendment. And folks, it won't be long till, I mean, listen, how did they get rid of guns in Australia? Simple. They said, hey, it's illegal to own a gun. If you own a gun in Australia, it's 10 years in prison. It's a felony. And it didn't take long. People decided they need to get rid of their guns. And the ones that kept them, guess what? Those who didn't started turning in the ones that kept them. And you just, and it's happened in all these foreign countries over in Eastern Europe when Christianity is outlawed, and in China when Christianity is outlawed. What happens? Well, you've got those who turn in their families. It's happening in this world today that we live in. It just hasn't landed in Paris, Texas yet. That doesn't mean it's not coming. We got to hurry. Heady's reckless, hurried on by your will or passion as a drunk man. You ever see a drunk man get his mind made up he's going to do something? Ain't nobody going to stop him. Amen. He's going to be like a bull in a china shop. He's going to do what he set out to do, and he may fight you on the way. That's the way people are about what they want to do in this world today. Hey, listen, I'll do what I want. It's my life. It's the way people talk. It's the way people act. And if we're not careful, we'll fall right in and say, you know what? It's my life. I want to do what I want to do. And that's the very message of Satan. Do what you want to. He don't care what you do as long as you don't do God's will. Just do what you want to. We've covered that before. Listen, that's the satanic principle. Do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. That's the satanic principle. High-minded to be so puffed up with haughtiness and pride as to be rendered stupid. You think you know so much and you don't know nothing. Amen? Listen, again, it's everywhere. People, listen, the Bible talks about that. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. It's all through the Scriptures. Anytime the Word of God is ignored, men do that which is right in their own eyes. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death, the Bible says. But men, listen, men get so high-minded they think they know better, and they just go right on to their own destruction. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, and we certainly live in the hour of pleasure. Romans 16:18 says, for they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. Philippians 3:18-19 said, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. Jude 4:19, for there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness. What is that, preacher? That's when, hey, listen, that's the mood of the American church today. Changing the grace of God into lasciviousness. Lasciviousness. Lasciviousness is lawlessness. That's whatever you want to do. You do what you want to. That's, hey, listen, there's Christians everywhere say it's okay if people want to marry their own race. I mean, not race, but their own gender. They want to marry their own gender. My goodness, it's okay for a man to be with man. It's okay for a woman to be with woman. It's okay. It doesn't matter. Hey, listen, whatever makes you happy. That's why people got rainbow flags all over their Facebook profiles, because they think, hey, it's okay. Christians claim to be Christians, folks. It's nothing but lies out of the pit of hell. You're not going to line up with Christ and line up with this world. You're not going to line up with Christ and line up with the sodomite crowd. It's just not going to happen. You can say, well, I'll just do whatever I want and be a Christian. No, ma'am, no, sir, you will not. You are going to ruin the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to smear Christianity everywhere you go if you just do things however you want to. Again, this book matters above all. And if we don't get in it, if we don't pay attention to it, it is going to be our own ruination. Right here, right now, in this day and time we live in. They turn the grace of God into lasciviousness, denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. These be they who separate themselves sensual. In other words, they do things according to their flesh, having not the Spirit. Again, that is the world's view of Christianity right now. Our view of Christianity is contrary day and night to the world's view. And what does God say? He says they have a form of godliness. Oh yeah, they walk around swinging their incense, they walk around in their robes, they walk around with their, and they bow down and kiss the toes of their statues, and they jump up and down and holler and shout about money, and they roll around the floor jerking and jumping and jiving and carrying on. And listen, they do all kinds of rituals and everything else pretending to be godly. God ain't in them. I'll tell you right now, Christianity produces a humble life. Christianity produces a servant, a humble servant, one who is more concerned about his standing before God than he is about anybody else's standing before him. A man who loves the Lord does not love this world. A man who loves the Lord hates this world, because he sees this world as an antagonist against the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a reason why we're referred to as pilgrims and strangers. We don't belong here. We're just sojourning. We're just here for a little while. And while we're here for a little while, we need to be careful that we don't let this world infiltrate our thinking. We don't let it infiltrate our lives, infiltrate our hearts. Don't let it turn us away from the truth that's in Christ Jesus. They have a form of godliness. That's how they're able to deceive the hearts of the simple, because they have all the trappings that the world looks at and says, oh, that's Christianity. By the way, they don't read this book. See, they can hold up a cross and everybody says, oh, they're Christians. Do you know that porn stars wear crosses around their neck? You know Madonna wears a cross around her neck? Remember old George Michael? He used to wear a cross around his neck. Listen, I'm telling you right now, all of them have crosses around their neck. And they do it in mockery. They do it in mockery. That's not religion. I'll take it back. That's religion. That's not Christianity. It's just a form of godliness. It's just there to fool you, to dupe you. But the Bible says they're denying the power thereof. See, the power is not in an outward display. Power is in an inward walk with Christ. The Bible says, from such, turn away. Turn away. Turn. Here's what you're to do. You're to turn away from it. You and I are never going to change it. That's something we need to get through. I'm closing. You and I are never going to change it. And the most we try to do, we're never going to change this old world. It is on a collision course with what the Word of God says is going to happen. So in the middle of it, right now, in these perilous times that we're living in, they're going to get harder to take. It's not going to get better from here. It's going to get worse. It's going to get harder to live as a Christian. So you better take heed to the things the Word of God's warning you about, because each and every one of those characteristics of an ungodly man are going to creep into the churches whereby we're in and around us, and it's going to be harder and harder and harder to stand for Christ, and you're going to have His strength more and more and more and more. You're going to have to go to that Bible more often and more often and more often to make sure that you're walking the path that He wants you to walk. We've got to be careful, folks, and we've got to turn away from the things that He's warned us about. He's turn away. Where am I turning to? I got news for you. 2 Corinthians 6:17-18. Wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, and touch not the unclean thing. And the Lord says, and I will receive you. Understand something. We're not turning away and wandering. We're turning away and running into the arms of our Savior. We're turning away and running to God and saying, Lord, hold me up with the everlasting arms. Hold me in the hollow of thy hand. Cover me in the shelter of thy wings. You are my high tower. You're my fortress. You're my buckler and my shield. Oh, He'll protect you, folks. We got to come out. Listen, if you've seen any of these things creeping into your life, I urge you this morning, go to God in repentance and say, Lord, please forgive me for allowing these kind of thoughts, these kind of things into my life. Lord God, cleanse me, heart, mind, soul, body. Get me right with Thee and keep my feet on the right path. Lord God, please help me and bless me this morning. If we'll come out from among them, He said, I'll be a father unto you. I need Him to be a father to me. Oh, I just need to lay my head upon Him and say, Lord, I don't know what to do. There's some days where I struggle. There's some days where it seems like everything piles up on top of me. But in those times, listen to me, He's always been a father to me. But I got to turn away from the garbage of this world, and you got to turn away from the garbage of this world. If not, we'll never be able to stand for Christ when things get really tough. We need to do business with God. Let's stand together this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank Thee. We thank Thee for the message this morning. Lord of God, I pray we've taken it to heart. Lord, I pray, Father, that we'll continue to think on it. Lord, we'll not forget it as we go about our way to eat lunch and do our business today. Lord, I pray to God, and I pray to You, Lord, I thank You, Father, and I ask You, please, to help us to stand. Help us to stand in this hour of confusion. Oh, Lord God, I pray, Father, that You'll please, please bless us and please help us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we have a song of invitation, if the Lord moved on your heart, please visit the altar and do business with God. I appreciate you, your listening, and I appreciate you, your time this morning. And my hope and prayer is that we'll take heed to these things that we've heard, and we'll pay attention to what's going on around us, that we do walk circumspectly, that we are conscious of what's taking place around us, and that we stand valiant for truth, that when we hear error, that we correct it. When we see something that ought not be, that's demeaning the cause of Christ, that we stand for what's right, we speak up, speak out. Folks, we've been called to stand for God. And we've got to be valiant for Christ. I'm going to tell you, the rewards, you won't believe. You know, somebody said, rewards are out of this world. They are. Amen. If we just stand for Him, we'll find out that, listen, someday we're going to stand before Jesus. Amen. And I want Him to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I want to hear that more than anything. But again, He won't say well done if you hadn't done well. So let's do well in His power, in His strength. Amen.